from this lady in red to you viewers at home. Yes, you're welcome to the program. This is Let's Talk, showing every Saturday and Sundays, 8:30 on Super Screen Television. As always, I'm your host of the program, and my name is Peculiar Eziam. Yes, it's still the year 2020. We are still in our new year vibe, and I'm going to be giving it to you people hot this year, as you can see. But I hope you enjoyed the show, and we love your feedbacks, your messages, your remarks, everything. Keep it coming. We'll definitely be responding to you as they come in. I have to go on a short break right now so I can bring in Nkechi and our amazing guests for today. And of course, we'll tell you the topic, but you just have to sit back. Hold on. Wait for it. It's coming. Just gotta get your popcorn. Get your juice box, tell another person that fine girl of Super Screen Television is here again, and it's time for Let's Talk. So Let's Talk will be right back. Just stay with us. Welcome back to the program. Yes, thank you for watching. This is Let's Talk, showing every Saturday and Sunday on Super Screen Television. Right now, Nkechi is in the studio with me, and she's looking nice. So, Nkechi, hi.
Hi.
I like that slit in your dress, even if you're not seeing me. I like the fashion touch of that slit. I always love a slit in the dress.
You know, thank
just
you.
Just to show the legs and all. And right now, our guest is in the studio with us. We have Eziaha Bolaji-Olojo in the studio. Hi!
Hi, everybody! Thank you so much for having me. Happy New Year!
Yes!
2020 is not just a year, I feel like it's a decade.
Yes!
Like, Happy New Decade!
Welcome on Let's Talk, guys. You can see she's already excited to be on the show. How does it feel to be here? Let's Talk.
Okay, I love TV, I love cameras, I did a lot of it in school, so I'm super excited to be here. I'm so excited, thank you so much for having me.
You're welcome.
I have an amazing time.
Thank you for coming.
Okay, as usual, you know what segment it is. It's time for our fun fact segment, and we'll be giving you fun fact based on the topic for today. So we hope you put one or two together to get the topic. Okay, so let me start with mine. My fun fact for today is your motherly smell is recognized by your baby within few meters, and this alone can stop them crying in a few seconds. Oh, so cute. I think that's true, right?
Well, I think that is true on a general note. The mother-child bond is incredible, and I've seen it manifest in so many ways. So yes, I'd agree with it to a large extent, say 90%, but you know there are always exceptions to any rule.
Yeah.
Yep. I'll say let's keep that 10 for those moms who are like, no, it's not true. Depending on you, that's where you're from, but on a general note, it's very true.
All right, so my own fun fact for this week is during breastfeeding, a mother can literally feel when her baby is hungry. It is like a sixth sense, and not only because her breasts are filled with milk.
You're the mother here.
So is it true? Is that like a sixth sense, you know, feeling and...
Well, I actually think that the fact that your breasts are full is a prompt that can quieten every other thing, because it's painful, it's uncomfortable. So before thinking of the sixth sense, you can actually feel something. I believe there's a sixth sense, but personally, just the fact that your breasts are engorged, honey, you're gonna go and find your baby immediately. Your baby is hungry. Even if your baby is not hungry, you start expressing milk or doing something to make things easier. So yes, I'll say that.
Okay, so to my viewers, if you guessed, and probably you guessed it right, yes, we're tracing something on motherhood today. Our topic for today is motherhood after the birth of a child, the struggles and the triumph of being a stay-at-home mom, like our guest for today. So it's going to be a lovely one today, guys. We got you covered. So generally, I just want to ask, how does it feel to be a mom?
Oh my gosh, I love that question. Okay, I believe that is one of the greatest gifts from God, being a mom, the privilege, like I like to say, of motherhood, just you knowing that something is growing on your inside, and then you go through the entire process of 40 weeks or 42 weeks, like some of us, we just never do 40 weeks. It has to be over the 40 weeks. So we're looking at 10 months of being pregnant and then giving birth, no matter the experience, whether it was a vaginal birth or a C-section, no matter how horrible or how great it was, when you hold that baby, it almost feels like you forget all the pain and you're just excited about the beautiful future. It's such a gift from God. You get to steward a child. You get to write. It's a blank canvas that you have been given. You get the privilege of writing on it. You better do a great job with it. So I see it as an absolute privilege, and which is why I'm always so in faith with other people who are trusting God for children, because it's a gift that every woman who desires it should enjoy.
Oh, wow. She's making me want to have a baby.
You spoke about
I had to ask her that question first to establish that she's a mom. Well, our guest for today, her name is Eziaha Bolaji-Olojo, like I already said, and she's the health and fitness coach, a stay-at-home mom for some time, but now she's a health and fitness coach. So I just wanted to establish that by that question. So continue.
You were talking about the kinds of birth. Does it matter? Because some women in this part of the world make a big deal on, you know, the vaginal birth or the C-section. So does it matter? Does one kind of birth, you know, make one person more of a mother than the other person? Or even surrogacy mom, like, you know, the different kinds of...
Okay. In the past, I would have answered this question as, no, it doesn't matter, and make it just straightforward like that. Yes, I still think it doesn't matter, but there are nuances to this thing. It's not as straightforward as that. For some women, and I get emails on a regular like that, where women are like, I had my baby through CS and I've been hiding it. It almost, I'm like, I don't understand why. But we cannot discount the fact that they feel that way because of what society has done to program us to feel like the vaginal birth, which we erroneously call normal birth. Honey, it's not normal birth. It's vaginal and C-section. So don't call it, every birth is normal. There's nothing abnormal about a C-section. So for some women, it's a big deal. Even for some men don't want their women to go through the C-section because there's so much myth and there's so much, I don't know what to say about it. For instance, I have two boys. My first was a vaginal birth and my second was a planned C-section. I wanted to know what it felt like. I wanted to know if maybe we're different, maybe the children will be different, but they're not different. You don't, there's nowhere that is written where children born through C-section come this way, or mothers who had, a C-section birth come this way. So really, when it comes right down to it, it's your choice. And again, it's not your choice. It's the medical professional's choice because we're trying to save a life. So this is me telling you that it's okay. Your delivery route for your birth really doesn't matter if you have the right professional help. And forget this thing about your tummy will never go down and all that stuff. It will go down. You will get your life back. There's nothing wrong with a C-section. There's nothing wrong with a vaginal delivery. Whatever works for you. Like I say, the best kind of birth is the kind that brings forth a healthy mother and a healthy baby. Even if you shout them out of your mouth.
It's actually true. I just wanted to add to you, I have a friend who had both of her children through C-section. It wasn't really her choice. So it's not, sometimes it's not their choice. It's the best that doctor will advise to them, and then they will have to do it. Then if you want to criticize, what will you say about those that didn't have a child, like after years in marriage and then probably adopted or went through surrogacy, IVF? Just so many things that are coming up right now. The main aim is to have that child, because at the end of the day, everything stops and the child becomes your number one priority.
Yeah,
I don't know about your mom yet, but I think it's something like that, right?
Yes. And children are not just born of your body, they're also born of your heart. Which is where the adoption thing comes in. I don't think that you should wait for so many years. I feel like adoption is something we should adopt. Oh, I love that.
Adoption is something we should adopt.
So just because they're children who are really in need, lots of babies. I mean, just go to the nearest orphanage, you hear all kinds of stories. So I think that we don't have to wait until we've spent some X number of years waiting. You can actually just make adoption, even if you have your own child. If it's something you can, that's something I'm actually considering. We're considering as a family, adopt a child, because children are born of your womb the bottom of your heart.
They didn't create the circumstance they are in for themselves. So does that make them any less of a child just because they don't have a mother taking care of them? So why not be the mother taking care of them? I mean, we should just love children in general.
I like what she said about the heart thing. I think what you've established about children being born of the heart is a really big deal that people do not concentrate on. So that's, I hope, has reorientated some people to be able to do better.
I hope so too.
All right, so we didn't just come to talk about what kind of way to give it. We want to talk about the struggles and the triumph of being a stay-at-home mom. She's no longer a full-time stay-at-home mom, but she has been a stay-at-home mom, so she understands very much what we're talking about. So let's talk about the struggle and the challenges, the trials, everything.
Okay, so I'm actually a stay-at-home mom.
Domestic queen, like she calls us.
Yes, domestic queens. We get to manage this kingdom that, you know, has so graciously been given to us to manage. So over and above everything that I do, I consider and I prioritize my domestic queen status over and above every other thing. I think the one reason why we don't want to talk about it is because it's not bringing us money. So it almost feels like, let me talk about the one that's bringing me money over and above the one that's not bringing me money. But the truth is that there's purpose to everything. It's not money. Money doesn't determine purpose. Can we just put that on a t-shirt? Money doesn't determine purpose. Your obedience, your stewarding the assignments in front of you, right, is really what determines purpose and how good and well you get to be judged on earth here. So yes, I am still a stay-at-home mom. I happen to run a business, but still from home. And every time I even, you know, bring my business up in prayers, I always say, as we grow, I still want to do it from home. So let's build the business, let's build it from home. Because it's a privilege. I think it's a double privilege to work and then be close to your children. So you're earning economic income, but you're not compromising on anything like family and all that. So yes, the number one challenge, since we're talking about money, has to be money. Because just a little bit of my story, I went to the nation's best university. Please, no argument here. University of Ibadan.
So no argument here.
I graduated with a first class. I was best graduating student. All through my final year, I wanted to work in with a particular international organization. So I did all my courses to favor that thing. So I'm there, and I get the job. It's a dream job. It's in Abuja. It's like, woo, your career is going, girl. And then after some time, I get pregnant. It's supposed to be an exciting day, right? And I'm super excited about it. But you have a baby. I was living in Abuja at the time, and I was living with a family member. My husband happened to work outside. He was not around at the time, so I was living with a family member. Girl, we all know that you can't give birth to a child in a family member's house. Mm-hmm. You have to be in your own place. So I didn't really have any solid support system apart from the family member I lived with. And with the pregnancy growing and all that, something had to give because I had to go and join my husband, and we had to start to build as a family. And the job couldn't live with me. So guess what gave? The job. The dream job. The job that we took all our final year courses to make sure we got the job. The job that we believed for every single day, it had to give. So when I talk to stay-at-home moms or domestic queens who have that challenge of, oh, I had this amazing job and I had to drop it, the economic challenges are very real because you don't have the money that you easily had before. You no longer have it. You have to depend on your husband for everything. And it can be humbling, especially if the man is not very sensitive of your season. And let's face it, without any disrespect to men, I love men, I love my husband, I respect him, I honor him. But a lot of times, men are not very sensitive. So it almost feels like, what are you doing for herself? What are you even doing all day? So it looks like what you're doing doesn't matter. But it actually does matter. So just dealing with a woman who had economic power before, she had the money before, but now she has to depend on her husband for everything, including money for the most basic things like sanitary condition, things that are for your sanitary health. You have to depend on your husband for it. It can be very challenging. So I'd say that's a major challenge, the economic challenge. However, even for a woman who did not have a job before outside the home and didn't earn money, it can still be challenging because maybe this was not what you planned to do. You didn't plan to stay at home. Circumstances made you stay at home. So it can be very challenging. It can still be very humbling. And then guess what? There's Instagram. You're going to see everybody and their dogs and their cats all living the life. For me, there was this lady. I used to just really follow her. And I was so jealous of her life because we had a baby at the same time. She had come back to Nigeria. And she just went straight back into work. Like nothing happened. She didn't miss a beat. and she would put hashtag. She would put all her nice posts and she would put hashtag working mom. And I'm like, damn, this is my life. I was supposed to be a working mom. So I really despised the season that I was in. So yes, the economic factor is one of the major, major challenges. But you see, while money is important, you need to understand that seasons don't last forever. There's also a possibility that because it's a one-income home, some people have it good, like your husband is making enough money for three families, so you're good. But for a lot of us, like my case was, because we had moved from a two-income home to a one-income home, there were real economic challenges. I had to learn that the lady on Instagram was not me. I couldn't live life on her terms. So one of the things you're going to have to quickly do is sit down and be honest with your season, with your timings. Are there things that you cannot afford at the time? Do you have to take buses instead of cabs, or you can't afford a car? My sister, it's for a season. It's not going to last forever. How we steward this season that is going to pass. Maybe at some point your kids are going to grow. You're going to get back to the work world. You're going to start a business. Things are going to happen and your season is going to change. So don't see it as forever. If there are changes you need to make to your lifestyle for the time being, please make it and be very proud of it. I remember this particular story.
Okay, I'm going to hold you there. Before you say this story, viewers, I hope you can see we did a very nice choice and selection of guests to take this topic with us. But I also have to establish that we are very, very much interested in how you start your year and how you continue 2020. So we've dedicated the full of January to treat topics that will inspire different ranges of audience. Last week we did something very inspiring. This week again we have Eziaha here treating something inspiring. This is basically out there to the stay-at-home moms and the mothers or siblings of stay-at-home moms to understand your struggles too. And for the stay-at-home mom, it's for you to know that, oh, there's a life and a purpose. Are you enjoying your purpose while being a stay-at-home mom? We have to take a short break to pay our bills. In case you have a product or service you want to showcase on the platform, the numbers are showing on the screen. Do call and we'll direct you on how to go about that. In case you have a comment or an experience you want to share with the topic we're discussing right now on the studio, do text it to our WhatsApp number or send us a DM and we probably will read your comments on the next episode. If you have questions you want to ask to our guest, send it to our WhatsApp number and we'll direct it to her and we'll also send back the replies to you. So do stay with us. Let's talk right back. Welcome back to the program, or should I say welcome back to Let's Talk. We still have Eziaha in the studio with us and we're still discussing the triumphs and the struggles of a stay-at-home mom. And in case you're just joining the program right now, we are basically treating this topic to explain to you all the struggles of being a stay-at-home mom. Many people just look at them as, what are you doing with your life? Did they marry you to be a trophy wife? Didn't you have goals before getting married and everything? But no, you have to understand the major, the priority or the number one most important thing to all stay-at-home moms, which I believe is the child, right? And that's the reason behind every decision they make. So you can continue with your hand.
Okay, I love what you talk about, the priority being the child, not just the child, your family. Because sometimes you're so like, I need to get back to work, I need to get back to work. And then you're compromising your family, you're compromising your marriage. Because it's. I like to look at things on the long term. Sometimes we're very short-sighted. Every time I look at things long term, it gives me perspective. So you're excited about something now. I feel like I get it. I need to get a job. And I talk to a lot of domestic queens who go ahead and get that job, and because it's paying you 100,000 naira, that's short term. You're excited about it. But guess what? What is the opportunity cost of that job that you have gotten? Who knows? You have to pay a nanny or a crèche. there's a tendency that your children start to fall. There's a tendency actually they start to fall ill a little bit more, so you get to pay better and more hospital bills. Maybe take more time off work. There's the extra expenses that comes from taking your child outside the home and then you being outside the home too. At the end of the day, would you say that it was worth it getting that job? And this is not about the amount. I'm just looking at the opportunity cost. What is it costing your marriage? Because again, you're looking at it short term. Oh, look at my friends. And I was talking about the whole comparison thing, because that's one thing that really, really, really affects domestic things. You're constantly comparing yourself with somebody else on Instagram and she has this amazing life and you feel like I'm better than you normally. But given the circumstances, look at how my life is. You don't need to compare. You need to figure out what is the best thing, what is the best path for my life right now, for my season right now. I'm fully immersed in it. There's really no need to compare. I know we hear it a lot, but I don't think I can overemphasize. You don't have to compare your life, your season, your reality, your portion with another person's own. Whatever has been put in front of you now, like I said, like I tell my stay-at-home mom, my domestic queen, your home is a holy ground. This is where you have been called to in this time. When you take your eyes off every other person and fully immerse in this holy ground, you start to see endless possibilities. That was how my story as a fitness coach started. It wasn't that, oh, I was here, I needed money, oh, I need to do something from home, because that's the next mistake that we make. We just feel like we must do something from home. I must be making money from home. Look, it's a great thing and it's a privilege to make money from home. However, if that is not your season, be comfortable with it. My journey started by just being faithful with my season. So because I was very frustrated being a stay-at-home mom, I used to fight my husband a lot. Things were just so bad in my marriage. I started to eat and I gained a lot of weight. I was weighing over 100 kg. I was so big. And then at some point I realized that, girl, this is not the life you signed up for. Because you don't have this fantastic job anymore, and because you're now a stay-at-home mom, didn't mean that you should completely lose out on your life. And I decided, I commit to losing weight. There was no pressure, nobody was disturbing me. I just said, oh, Eziaha, you're more than this. I said more than in school. So I'm like, how could you lose yourself so much that you have gained all this weight? And I started to lose the weight. And I was very faithful with it. I didn't just lose it gradually. I made noise about losing it. I made noise on Instagram. I was constantly researching because I'm very smart. I'm like a book person. So I made I did a lot of research, immersed myself into that weight loss thing. I lost 30 kg within 4 months. My transformation was radical. And people are like, oh, what did you do? What did you do? And I started to help people for free. It was never about money. I was comfortable with my season. I was comfortable saying, I'm a stay-at-home mom. I didn't necessarily need to say, oh, but I worked in the United Nations before. No, I was comfortable saying what it was at the time. So from helping people for free, I realized, hey, we could start a business from this, and a business is birthed from there. I've had people who are just making amazing baby food at home because they're trying to feed their babies better. And people are like, oh, can you make this thing for me? And boom, a business is birthed from there. Some people are just immersing in reading to their children, teaching them how to read and how to write. And they do it so well that their children start to get better and better. And some parents are like, how did you do this? I needed to help me teach my child. And boom, a business is birthed from there. So you see, the goal is really not money. The goal is that I immerse in my season. I do the best with what has been put in front of me now. And who knows where it can take you. That's really my story.
So how do we shield, or how can stay-at-home moms be shielded from this buzz of just wanting to move fast, especially in our generation? What should they look to? What can they look at? What can they keep as their focus to, you know, be shielded from the buzz, anxiety, and comparison like you're talking about, like practically?
I love it when you talk about anxiety, because it's not a term that we fully own in the country, but anxiety is real. I think even traffic can give us anxiety. So I understand anxiety. One of the things that I had to do, and for me, I can be an all or none person. I can be cold turkey. I cut off completely from social media. I felt like in trying to fully understand my season, I didn't want distractions. I didn't want to feel like, oh, today I'm happy with my husband.
Yeah.
And then next tomorrow, I just see someone whose husband bought her a pair of shoes.
And then
like,
you're already...
I didn't want to go back to the car and then just start with a pair of shoes. So I had to cut off. It's almost like someone who smokes. You don't say I'll smoke once a week. It's going to be really hard because you're not starving the appetite. So I had to starve the appetite completely. After some time, you kind of have built enough self-esteem, enough willpower, your convictions are deeper, then you can gradually introduce it back. So I had to cut off from social media. I also had to cut off from some certain friends, because they were not helping my life. We used to bash our husbands together. We used to bash our seasons together. So I had to cut off from them just so I could have a better focus. I feel like for us to focus, which is something that we struggle with a lot, you need to be brutal. about cutting out distractions, then I started to positively surround myself, actually very passionately surround myself with only people that would help my journey. I was not looking for anything fancy on Instagram anymore. Once I identified a teacher who had answers for me, I would dig in. I would lean into that person all the way. So again, so the steps are really simple. I cut off from the distractions. I cut off from my friends. And I took my focus to people who were helping me on this journey.
What a support system.
Say that again.
Support system.
Oh, and then support system at home. Because one of the things that you have to be at home, and that's a mistake that a lot of stay-at-home moms make, you just feel like, I can wake up at any time. After all, there's nothing putting external pressure on my time. So you sleep and you wake up at 9 o'clock, or maybe your kids got to go to school. So you wake up at 6, but once they go to school, you get back to bed and sleep. Honey, we're not doing that in 2020. Amen. We're not doing it in 2020. We're going to have a time when we wake up, when we sleep, and we're going to structure our day. So when we talk about support system, because I know that a lot of us cannot do it alone. So in my case, I've had various support systems, from taking my child or children to the crèche to when they got to your school is a support system. When your child goes to school, that's for some of us 7 o'clock to 3 o'clock. That's a long time. You can invest your time in other things at that time. That's, if you have children who go to school. For babies, when they sleep, you can do something. Of course, there's a support system of having a domestic help. I know some people's husbands are like, I don't want anybody in my house. My sister, that's very, very hard. So you pray about it, you get people to talk to him. I've had times when I've had to set up someone that the man respects to talk to him, and then at that point it's like, okay, let's take the domestic help. Because men don't understand that. We're not just sleeping at home. Domestic work is a big deal. Even taking care of a child is a big deal. So having the domestic help, if you can afford your mother, your mother-in-law, you need a solid support system depending on your home. Sit down and figure out which one works best for your home and then go after it.
So good. Okay, so how can women deal with husbands that are not understanding? I mean, so you spoke about, you know, speaking. Some people have gone through this
route. I like
route,
that smile. Yes,
and they're just like,
there's a story behind that.
Yeah, smile. Like, they're just, no. Some women do, some husbands are not just understanding, and they want to do these things that you've said, but they are quite frustrated, and maybe they've not met support system, you know, as good as you. What do you advise them to, you know, immediately start to do, or at least bear with, to get them working on their journey?
I thought about this question and I hoped it wouldn't come.
No, that's why you need to stop.
It's a hard thing. So I'm going to quickly, if you're single watching this, I'm going to say, please be sure of who you're getting married to. It's a big deal because the man is still the head of the home.
Yes,
true. He's still the head of the home. He's going to make decisions that you would want to revel, but you can't because he's the head of the home. So make that right choice. However, if you're already in it, there's one thing I'll say. You possibly don't want to hear it, but I'll say, be patient. Be prayerful about it, but as you pray, be patient. And sort of like lay it down. I know that it's hard, but lay it down. You wanted to do this, but lay it down. You wanted to do it late because you're not trying to lose your marriage. You don't want to do the one that you will now become, will now be praying that your husband will come back. We don't know where he has gone to. He has abandoned the marriage. You don't want to
very
do
true, yeah.
So I'll say patience. Mm. Patience is the game changer on this journey. Be patient and prayerful.
All right. Thank you so much. Our time is up. That's just the summary of it all. Just say your last word. Like, just something very short. Very short. I'm taking a week. There.
This is a season. It's temporary. And it can be as good as it needs to be if you would just sit down and immerse in it. Your season is perfect.
All right, thank you so much, Eziaha. Nkechi.
Okay, so from all we've learned, I would say find purpose in your season. That's what, find purpose in your season.
All right, a very wonderful session it was today. To pick one or two from the single moms at home, from the husband side, from the friend side, and from the spinsters looking forward to getting married. And my word of advice just goes to the husband. Like, it's easy for you to want something, but also be patient with your wife. There are nicer approaches to getting her to doing whatever you want her to do. So I just feel the marriage is not like a one wheel. It's both of you. So you should just carry each other along. There are sometimes when he's leading, and there are sometimes where she's ahead. So I just feel, understand your home and know what works for it. We are not discriminating working moms. Like, it's a wonderful thing also. But we just wanted to empathize on the stay-at-home mom, with them rather. So thank you so much. We hope you enjoyed this episode. We'll be seeing you same time next week. Bye-bye.